दिस इज इंग्लिश शॉर्ट हैंड डिक्टेशन नंबर 194 एंड द डिक्टेशन स्पीड इज 120 वर्ड्स पर मिनट. रेडी स्टार्ट. आई हैव ग्रेट प्लेजर इन वेलकमिंग यू टू दिस ट्राइपार्टाइट लेबर कॉन्फ्रेंस. आई कैन हार्डली कन्वे टू यू एडिक्वेटली द सेंस ऑफ ग्रेटिट्यूड विच आई एंड द गवर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडिया फील फॉर द रेडी रेस्पॉन्स विच यू हैव गिवन टू आवर इन्विटेशन एंड द ट्रबल दैट यू हैव टेकन टू बी प्रेजेंट हियर दिस मॉर्निंग. आई होप एंड ट्रस्ट दैट दिस रेडी रेस्पॉन्स ऑन योर पार्ट विल बी फॉलोड by an equally willing cooperation in making this conference a success and in carrying through its purposes to fruition. I do not wish to detain you long. These are days of grave emergency and I realize that everyone must return to his post as soon as he can. I will not therefore make any lengthy speech on this occasion but will contain myself with touching upon a few points with a view to bringing home to you the significance of the conference and to state its aims and objects. As you know, there have been so far 3 labor conferences held in New Delhi under the auspices of the Labor Department of the Government of India. The present conference is thus the 4th of this series. You will realize the significance of this conference better if I tell you in as few words as I can the special features which mark off this conference from the previous ones. In the first place, although the previous conferences met regularly at certain fixed periods, permanency was not a part of the plan of those conferences. There could have been a break in their regularity and the idea could have been abandoned without doing violence to any rule or convention or understanding. The present conference has permanency as a part of its plan. The organization that we want to set up will have the permanency and regularity of a standing committee, ready to function when called upon to do so. More important than this feature of the conference is the second feature to which I want to draw your particular attention. It relates to the composition of the conference. The previous conferences were representative of governments only. The representatives of the central government, provincial governments, and some of the Indian states governments formed the only constituents of the conference. The most necessary and the most important elements, namely the employers and the employees, were not represented at these conferences. Care was no doubt taken to establish contact and even to consult the organizations representing the employers and the employees. For instance, my honorable friend Shri Mudaliar, when he was the member in charge of labor, did take occasion to meet the representatives of labor and of employers during his visit to Calcutta. Similarly, my honorable friend Shri Firoz Khan, to whom we owe the project of the present conference, did seek occasion to take counsel with the organizations of employers and employees during his tenure of office as labor member. It is for the first time, however, in the history of these labor conferences that the representatives of the employers and the employees have been brought face to face within the ambit of a joint conference. To my mind, this is a feature of the conference which should find a very ready welcome from all concerned, and particularly from the representatives of the employees. Ever since the Whitley Commission, in its report on labor in India, put forth the proposal that there should be established in India as a permanent body an industrial council, the representatives of labor have agitated for effect being given to that recommendation. For various reasons, it did not until now become possible to realize the ideal of an industrial council. I do not claim that the proposal which this conference is called upon to give effect to amounts to a complete realization of that cherished ideal. But there can be no doubt that this conference seeks to pave the way towards the realization of that ideal. And I am sure you will not deem it an exaggeration if I say that it marks a long stride on the road which leads to that goal. I will now say a word or two with regard to the aims and objects of this conference. Some of you who are familiar with the proceedings of the previous conferences will know that one of the primary objects which brought those conferences into being was the great desire to avoid the danger arising out of the diversity in labor legislation with which this country was threatened as a consequence of provincial independence in labor legislation. So long as the government of India was a unitary government, uniformity in labor legislation was not difficult to obtain. But the federal constitution created by the Government of India Act of 1935 by including labor legislation in the concurrent legislative list had created a very serious situation. It was feared that if there was no central legislation, each province might make a particular law especially suited to itself, but different from that of its neighbor by allowing provincial considerations to dominate over considerations of general and national importance. The conferences were called to supply a most necessary corrective to this tendency and to foster among provincial governments a regard for the wholesome principle of uniformity in labor legislation. In constituting this conference, I do not propose to abandon this object of uniformity in labor legislation with which the three previous conferences were mainly concerned. It will remain one of the objects which the conference will pursue. But I would like to add two other objects, namely the laying down of a procedure for the settlement of industrial disputes and the discussion of all matters of All India importance as between labor and capital. Our conference will have, therefore, three main aims and objects, namely the promotion of uniformity in labor legislation, the laying down of a procedure for the settlement of industrial disputes, and the discussion of all matters of All India importance as between employers and employees. In regard to the first, it is unnecessary to say why we have included it in our aims and objects. Uniformity in labor legislation can never cease to be a matter of importance to so large a country like India, with its many administrative and provincial jurisdictions. It must therefore continue to occupy our attention in the future as it has done in the past. As to the industrial disputes, both labor and capital have, once in war, behaved with a sense of responsibility, and the number of strikes that have taken place has not been on a very extensive or disturbing scale. There was some tendency at the beginning of this year for an increase in industrial unrest, but the laying down of a procedure for adjudication of disputes under the Defense of India Rule 81A has resulted in some reduction in recent months. That procedure will prove an efficient and a reliable machinery, but it is a procedure for the settlement of industrial disputes as one of the aims and objects of the conference which we propose to set up. in designing the last item included in our aims and objects, we have deliberately used wide language so as not to exclude from the deliberation of the conference anything that is of importance to labor and capital.